The setting is the border zone between Turkey and Syria, the upheavals and horrors of the Syrian civil war as they play out for a group of individuals. The stuff of today's headlines given fictional life in the new novel, Dark at the Crossing. Author Elliot Ackerman lives in Istanbul and has reported from this area. He's a former Marine who served in Iraq and in Afghanistan, the setting of his first novel, Green on Blue. And welcome to you.
Thanks for having me.
I mentioned that this is an area that you've come to know, but where does the idea for a novel come in? And which came first, the novel or getting to know this world?
I think something I'm interested in my writing is often political themes. But, you know, when we look at a lot of these political issues, whether it's what's going on in Afghanistan or the wars in Syria, the wars in Iraq, I mean, they're incredibly complex and in some ways almost impenetrable. And I think one of the great things you can do with story, and particularly with a novel and character, is you can take a lot of these themes that are central to what's going on in the world, but really distill them down into a single narrative. And so that's what I try to do in my fiction.
You've got the obvious in-your-face drama of war, and you've got the geopolitical themes, right? But you have to give it a personal face. So how do you do that?
I think you do it with character. You know, you start, you know, this novel is really about three characters. The first is a man named Harris Abadi, who's an Iraqi American. He's really sort of someone of two identities, born in Iraq but a naturalized American, who for a variety of reasons wants to go fight in Syria. And his efforts are stymied, and he meets up with a couple of Syrian refugees, a man and wife named Amir and Daphne, and you sort of learn their stories and the story of their loss. They lost a daughter in the revolution. And so what you see is a lot of these geopolitical themes kind of orbiting around these characters who are engaged in a, you know, in a pretty intimate narrative amongst the three of them.
Are these based on people that you met in some ways? Are you taking notes from your work and thinking, oh, here's where I can build a character or a story?
When you're having an experience, you know, there's certain questions that come up and themes that come up. And then once you sort of have bore down on the themes of the story, you start building out characters who are wrestling with those themes. I work kind of in a tradition that used to be more predominant, maybe is less so now, which is of novelists who were journalists.
Right.
You know, from the 20th century, we had a lot of that. We don't have that as much now, largely probably due to changes in how journalism works. But oftentimes when I'm out there, you know, these do seem like great places to set stories.
The main character you talked about, Harris, and he served as an interpreter with the U.S. forces in Iraq, and he decides to come back. Why?
You know, I think what's interesting about war in general is it can be, on the one hand, it can be almost a redemptive act. People will go to fight seeking some sort of redemption, but it could also be a sort of a very dark and nihilistic act. And sort of those two threads kind of are really splitting Harris. He doesn't know why he's necessarily going to fight. He just knows he's drawn back to the war. And part of that also comes to the fact that he's this man of two identities. He was an Iraqi who collaborated with the Americans during the war and then became an American citizen, but he feels conflicted between his American identity and his identity as an Iraqi. And so he's someone who resettles in the U.S., doesn't necessarily find the life that he wants there, but now that he's left Iraq, he can't go back. And so he is seeking, in some ways, and we don't know whether it's redemption or almost a sort of self-destruction.
You're giving voices to people that we often don't hear from, or we only kind of know about through the news, including ISIS fighters, the kind of hardline voice that we know is out there, but we don't usually see represented in fiction. You're humanizing them in some way.
I mean, heaven forbid, right? You humanize these people.
Yeah.
I think that's what's, you know, that's just because you're trying to humanize someone or you're trying to understand them, I think is very different. And we often conflate that with agreeing with somebody. Mm-hmm. And I think that's one of the great things that fiction has the power to do. You know, it allows you to create a character you might find despicable or you might, you know, with whom you might not agree, but then give them the power to, you know, to basically make their case as though they were making it before God.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, specific to some of like the journalism I met ISIS fighters and spoke with them and listened to them explain their beliefs. And some of their beliefs and some of the reasons they're fighting make sense. I mean, if you are a Sunni in that part of the world right now, you know, you're under threat politically from a whole bunch of various actors. So talking to those people doesn't necessarily mean I agreed with everything, but I could definitely start to understand at least their viewpoint. And then as a novelist, I wanted to, you know, take what I had learned and put it into a story. story.
And once you start the story, do you set all that aside, or do you keep your eye, one eye on the kind of ongoing events?
Well, I think by the nature of the work I do as a journalist, I'm still following these events as they're ongoing. But the story is set at a very specific time in Syria's war. Mm-hmm. It's the time when really in late 2013, when the revolution has at this point almost, it's becoming very evident that it's failed. As one of the characters in the book says, you know, the revolution is over, so the war can begin. And so it's that sort of moment where it's all fallen apart. Mm-hmm. So other events don't necessarily affect it as much.
The book is Dark at the Crossing. Elliot Ackerman, thanks very much.
Thanks for having me.